Hey there. Have you ever wondered when you're carriage driving your horse or pony, what is the right level of contact? You know, what's too much? What's too little? And how do you turn that level of contact into communication? Well, in just a minute, I'm going to go ahead and share a lot of information about that with you. But first, if this is your first time joining me for a video, let me introduce myself. My name's Andy Marcoux. I'm from coachmansdelight.com. And that's my website where I share all of my training tips and insights. I've been training horses professionally for about 25 years, really my only career. And I specialize in carriage driving horses. I also do a lot of long lining for dressage horses and a few riding lessons from time to time, but really it's all about the carriage driving. I'm up in Massachusetts, and I always ask people where they're from when you're joining me on Facebook, or maybe you're watching the replay on YouTube. So go ahead and throw down something in the comment section about where you're joining me from, because that's always really interesting. But you know what? This week, let's take it up a notch. Tell me what kind of carriage driving you're into. Do you like combined driving or draft horses, or do you just go out and goof around with your horse and that's really cool? And what kind of pony or horse do you have that you drive on a regular basis? So let's go ahead and get into things about contact and activation of the rein. I'm somewhat inspired to do this video by a post that I made maybe two, 3 weeks, a month ago. I'm not sure. But if you go onto my website, you can go through the blog posts and see a post about activating the rein. And what I had in mind when I was talking about activating the rein was that I use that term a lot in my lesson plans. You know, I'll say, you know, let's, you know, come around the corner and give a nice little rein activation at H, let's say. And some people wanted some definition on what exactly do I mean when I'm talking about activating the rein. And so I explain that in that post. I'll explain a little bit more right here. But then also the question that I get all the time is, how much contact should I have with my horse? The answer to how much contact should you have? Well, let's just start with contact. What I'm describing as contact is that connection and the draw on the rein that you have that connects your hand to your horse's or pony's bit while you're driving. And I often describe that in levels, you know. So like level one would just be maybe just enough to straighten those reins between your hand and the saddle of the harness. Whereas level 10 would be just absolutely pulling as hard as you can on the reins and probably wouldn't be able to sustain that for a long time. And so what's the perfect level? The formula for that is really quite simple. What you need to do is take the weight of your horse and multiply that by the weight of your carriage, divide out by a third if you have a two-wheel carriage, and three quarters if you have a four-wheel carriage. Take the curb weight of your rein. I'm kidding, of course. There is no perfect formula for how much contact should you have. It's really very much a horse by horse, driver by driver, you know, kind of continuum. And the level of contact doesn't always actually stay the same from, you know, if we have horse A and driver A, their contact at the beginning of the drive might be very different than what their contact is at the end of the drive or in the middle of the drive. It really very much depends on what you're doing with that horse and what you're trying to get out of that horse, what you're trying to communicate. Because remember, contact is all about communication. Without contact, you don't have communication. And this is kind of the thing that I keep running into. I do clinics, you know, all over the country. And when I you know, get in the carriage. One of the great things about carriage driving is that when I'm teaching you a lesson, I can sit in the carriage right next to you and I can reach over and I can touch your reins and I can put my hands on your hands and I can get an idea of what's going on in the moment that you're driving. And a lot of times what I'm finding is that people have way too little contact. And as I speak to people, I hear feedback that they're saying, well, Andy, I just want to have the least contact I can. I see it posted in places like here, like on Facebook. You know, I'll see somebody talking about contact and carriage driving in, you know, one of the chat areas, you know, like beginner carriage driving or some of those great groups. And I'll read somebody saying, you want to have the least possible contact. So you want to be driving on just silken reins where if you just barely pick up the rein, why, you just hardly have to use your fingertips on the reins. It would be so lovely. Yeah, sort of, but no. Because when you have such loose reins, you don't have communication. And so when you have a very loose rein like that, if you move your fingers and your wrist, which is where I want you to communicate from first when you're handling the reins, fingers and wrist, small movements, articulate movements, when you have very loose reins, those communications don't ever make it all the way down to the bit. I mean, you've got, what, anywhere from 6 to 8 feet, 10, 12 feet of rein out there from your hand to the bit going across that whole horse's body, and depending on how far your carriage is set behind your horse, boy, that's a lot of rein out there. So when you have very loose reins, all these little movements that, you know, I would teach you to do if I were giving you a driving lesson, well, they're not actually going to come through to your horse. He's never going to feel the communication because that loose rein isn't going to actually move the bit. And remember, the whole point of contact and the whole point of putting a bit in your horse's mouth is communication. And if you never move the bit, you never communicate. So when you have very loose reins, it's sort of like if I were to just kind of block my microphone here and then just talk a little bit under my voice and I'm just mumbling and you can't hear a bloody thing I'm saying, can you? Right? Because I've taken away the communication. If I take away the communication, you cannot respond to me. So, you know, if you're actually hearing me, and this is a new microphone, by the way, so hit the like button and let me know if you can actually hear all right. I know the sound on the last video was terrible. I got rid of that microphone. So you need enough contact to communicate. And like I said a moment ago, it's a progressive thing. So I'll share a story with you about my schoolmaster, Zach. So Zach was this really super duper cool Frisian. I never held the fact that he was a Frisian against him. I liked him anyway. And we had a lot of fun together and he taught a lot of people how to drive. And the way our contact worked was that we'd probably start out on very, you know, kind of mellow, loose contact, you know, just getting ready, working, getting him moving. And then as we started to work, that contact would start to kind of ramp up. And as we were getting further and further into, you know, a specific lesson plan or a specific exercise, then the contact would become quite high. You know, so maybe we'd start out on like a 1 or 2 or 3 level contact, but in the midst of getting our stuff together and pulling some kind of decent movement out of Zach, you know, we might be up there in that 7, 8, 9 range for a little while, but we'd hang out in that range until we got our timing together. We got our energy together. We got our connection together, because that's a lot of what contact is all about. It's about that connection between you and your horse. And then It was like, tell me if you've ever done this. Have you ever pulled a compound bow? I mean, if you've ever pulled a compound bow, like what a lot of people use to hunt with, you know, when you start pulling that bow, it's really tough to pull. It's really tough to pull. It's really tough to pull. And then when those pulleys on the bow flip over, all of a sudden you can just hold just like a pound or two of pressure, and you can hold that bow in the cocked position. Well, that's how it was with Zach. Like, we'd get there, we'd be like working really hard, and then all at once it was like those pulleys flipped over, and suddenly we'd have this very, very light contact, and little articulations would make big changes in his way of going. And all of a sudden, now we're back down to a four or three or four, and the articulations and the activations on the reins were down to just these little flips, little tiny activations upon the reins, because we had gotten that connection together. So that was, you know, a progression. And then as we finished the workout, maybe we'd get some little heavier contact for a moment, but then I'd relax the reins, especially when we're on our work home, on our walk home. But that kind of like, it's more of a progression and a continuum of contact. It's not just, you must have a four contact and no more and no less, and you must always have, you, that's not a sustainable way to try to drive your horse. And those activations, well, they change through the drive as well. So at the beginning of the drive, I might be using rather large hand and even arm movements to communicate. But by the time we got those pulleys flipped and we were just like in that like zone together, it was little short, quick activations. Now, when I talk about activating the rein, I'm talking about making an articulation with your wrists and fingers, maybe a little bit of elbow in there, but mostly fingers and wrists to actually kind of send a Morse code down the reins. And now, there's no better place that I can think of as an example of an articulation on the rein than when you're doing the activation phase of a half halt. You know, so that's when you're getting your horse ready for a downward transition or an upward transition or a turn, and you just give two or three quick little bumps and squeezes on those reins to let that horse know something is coming, right? It's just like ringing the bell. I think that's one of my favorite analogies that I had a coach use with me years ago, is he would just say, "Now, Andy, ring the bell." And then we would do our turn. You know, "Okay, Andy, ring the bell and make the transition." Now, when we're talking about what can the half halt do, what can activating the rein to create a half halt do for your horse? Well, a half halt's useful for improving your transitions. It's useful for creating good rhythm with your horse. It's great for engagement and collection and bending. Oh, everybody wants to know about bending, but they don't want to learn about the half halt. Oh, if you want to teach your horse how to bend, you better learn the half halt. Even for something as simple as your horse tripping. I mean, who out there has a horse who kind of on a regular basis trips? They might trip in the front end or they might trip in the back end. You'd be going through a transition or maybe just out for a regular, just recreational drive, and that horse is tripping all the time. You know, and you think maybe my farrier's doing a bad job. Well, maybe he is, but maybe you don't have that nice contact and that nice communication, and maybe you don't have a half halt to tell the horse to, you know what, why don't you walk on the bottom part of your foot? It works better. And the reason that half halt works for all of those things that I just listed is these issues all surround balance. And the half halt is the ultimate balancing tool and the ultimate balancing aid. I just took a little note for myself here to read you the definition. And I have to put on my glasses to read you my definition. I'm saying the definition. There is not one, the definition. Here's my definition of the half halt. A half halt is a command given through the reins, which we're talking about tonight, body and voice, to ask the horse to prepare and balance, collect, and adjust his current way of going to prepare for a new movement. A horse who understands a half halt will respond by engaging the abdominal muscles, you know, scrunching up his core, engaging the quadriceps, bringing the strides of his hind legs closer, further forward underneath the body. Weight bearing shifts towards the hindquarters, creating collection and engagement. Man, this is all awesome stuff, right? These actions balance the horse both laterally, like this, and longitudinally, length, right? To put more of his body into a position where he can make greater use of his body. Wow. All of that from a half halt. That's pretty awesome. Like, maybe you should learn about the half halt. And bringing this back into what tonight's subject is all about is that the half halt is a combination aid. It's a combination of rein activations and a little bit of a releasing aid on the rein and a little bit of a carrying aid on the rein. And so you have to kind of, you know, couple all those little rein activations into this neat little package that we call the half halt. Well, of course, there's that voice and body part of the half halt as well. But you want to put all of that together through your rein activations, with your rein activations, and with your contact. Now, if you want to learn more about the half halt, of course, please jump on over my website. If you just go coachmansdelight.com/half halt, that will bring you to where you can read about the half halt. There are articles, there are lesson plans, and of course, an online class all about the half halt where I show you how to put that into action. But this video is all about contact and activation. So how do you put this into use with your pony or your horse? Well, number one, I don't want you to try to satisfy a coach or a person or an ideal when it comes to rein activations and contacts, right? I want you to kind of seek out your own happy medium contact with your horse or pony. So choose a lesson plan that focuses in on contact. And what kind of lesson plans would those be? Well, something that focuses in on transitions, because you're having to use those reins, you're having to use a lot of activations on the reins during transitions. Or a lesson plan like developing the walk that comes with a lot of changes in contact. So in my developing the walk lesson plan, you do this kind of business-like, very serious walk, and then you turn across the short diagonal, and then you do the stretchy walk. So any one of those types of lesson plans that focuses in on changing your horse's length of frame and stride will help you navigate and find your level of contact between you and that horse. Also, like lengthening in the trot works really well for like focusing on what is the quality of my contact and where do I want that contact. And then just go out there and drive it, and don't expect that you're going to have the exact same contact from the beginning of the lesson plan to the end of the lesson plan. That contact is going to kind of change in quality, and it's really up to you to notice those changes and understand what created those changes in contact, and maybe forgive yourself if the contact is a little too heavy, or forgive yourself if the contact is a little too light. You've got to kind of experiment with it. Now, The one thing that I will say, the little piece of advice on, well, how do I know if my contact is too late? Well, if your reins are hanging out of your hand, like, you know, the bunting that we hang at 4th of July, you know, there's the little floop-de-doo things or garland on a Christmas tree. If those reins are just drooping like that between your hand and the carriage harness, well, that's probably not going to be a communicative contact. That's fine when you first start driving and the horse is just having like a little bit of lazy workout, a little walking, that kind of thing. Or maybe when you're done with your lesson and you're walking back to the barn. Yeah, some nice relaxed reins are great. But while you're in the midst of your lesson, that's when you should have more or less a relatively straight rein between your hand and the harness. Now, what's too much contact? Well, if you feel like you can't make, like you couldn't ring a bell. If you feel like you're holding on to those reins so hard that like making a ringing bell motion, think of how we ring a bell. I should have gotten my judge's bell and done the little ringing bell here. Anyway, great ideas. Should have thought of them before the video. If you can do little ringing bell motions and still maintain that contact, that's probably a really good communicative level of contact. And, you know, you're just going to go out and experiment, and it's not going to happen overnight. You're not going to find your way to the perfect contact between you and Fluffy Pants in one drive. You know, how Fluffy Pants goes on Monday might be different than how he goes on Wednesday and how he goes on Saturday. And of course, you're going to have differences in the way that you're handling the reins. You know, maybe Monday you're in a great mood because you just got done with an awesome weekend. You had so much fun and you're just relaxed. And then maybe by Friday, you know, you get to the point in the week where you really just want to throttle all of your coworkers and you're thinking about that. All of a sudden your contact is really stiff. So it's going to take quite a few workouts to start building up that skill and understanding. And, you know, it's not always going to be the same from one drive to the next. And that's okay. That's totally normal. That's part of carriage driving. You'll have this continuum all the way through your life with your horse. And, you know, it'll change drive by drive. It'll change week by week, year by year, largely depending on the types of things that you're working on. All right. So we're just at of a little bit more than 20 minutes here. And I just wanted to keep this short and simple. So you have a couple of short things to work on and think about. If you want to learn more about contact, but also I was talking an awful lot about the half halt, and man, I can't tell you enough about how much a half halt can improve your driving and your horse's way of going. By all means, go over to coachmansdelight.com/half halt, all one word. Or you can put a, maybe it's got a dash in there. You can put a dash in there, or you can just write it as one word. I'm pretty sure either way will work. And you're going to see a lot of great learning there available. We've got an online class coming up on that, that you can learn what you need to know about the half halt. If you are enjoying these live videos here on Facebook, and it looks like we've got a lot of people here on Facebook, I see Tina in there and Patty and Dot, and I know that Dot shared the announcement to this video with her friends on Facebook. And Dot, I really appreciate that. Big shout out to you for doing that. I know that Al is here from Colorado as well, and that's awesome. I'm so glad to see you guys coming in and joining this. The way to thank me for this is go ahead and share this video, and then get your butt over to YouTube, where I have a YouTube channel, and then go over in that bottom right hand side, hit the like button there and hit the subscribe button while you're there. If you're right now watching the replay on YouTube, just smash that thing. Just do me a favor. Support me in my supporting of you in your carriage driving by hitting that. And I really appreciate everybody's support. Go on over to coachmansdelight.com/online classes to check out what I've got for coming classes. Always got something good going on there. And you can actually view some of the classes that I've already given. All right. Thank you so much for being with me, and I will talk to you again soon. Take care.